word to us this morning, beloved, gives the gracious mind and will and purpose of our Lord Jesus Christ in his death. And death is the key word in our text. It's even mentioned three times, each time with respect to a different party. In verse 14, we read that Christ, through death, his own death, destroyed the devil. Later in that same verse, we read that Satan had the power of death. And in verse 15, we read that the elect, prior to their conversion, experienced the fear of death, their own death. Though sedulously avoided by most people, the Christian knows that death is a very crucial subject. And the Lord God, each time the Holy Supper is administered, brings before us the broken body and shed blood of Christ, which bespeaks his death. We are even called to remember the Lord's death till he come. And every one of us, unless the Lord Jesus returns first, will experience death, will taste it, will suffer it. And this word of God then this morning will help us in two main regards. First of all, we must grasp the means and ends of Christ's death. The means of Christ's death refers to what the Son of God had to do in order to be able to die. That is, he must become a man. The immortal God cannot die. And the ends are the goals and purposes of Christ's death, several of which could be mentioned. Our text specifies two. First, with regard to the devil, Christ's death was the means of destroying him. And then second, with regard to us, Christ's death is the way of his delivering us. Two ends proposed here in this text for Christ's death, and the means to his dying was his assuming a human nature. We need to grasp that, first of all, and then secondly, believing this afresh and more deeply, we have confidence regarding our own death, which will come in due time. Don't think that it won't. The devil, according to this word of God, no longer possesses the power of death over us. And thereby the Christian can overcome the crippling fear of death. And it cripples. And the Lord's Supper too has a role in this, as we're going to see. Let's consider then the means and ends of Christ's death. The means and ends of Christ's death. First, the means, the partaking of our nature, and then the two ends, the destruction of the devil and our deliverance from bondage. It all begins, beloved, with the blessed Holy Trinity, where ultimately everything begins. Begins with the Father and the Son enjoying infinite bliss in the Holy Spirit. It begins with the union and communion of perfect love and knowledge and delight, where everything begins. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That central statement, the Word was with God, means he is towards God, facing God, in communion with God. Even as the Son says in Proverbs 8, verse 30, then I was by him, as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. That's the Word, or the Son, before the Father. This triune God will, to glorify himself before rational, moral beings, especially man, whom he would create. God eternally planned to form a world with man as its pinnacle and crown, so that everything in the creation was under his foot. God, of course, too, decreed the fall of our first parents, Adam and Eve, into sin and misery and death. And in grace and mercy and pity, Jehovah willed to save some of our fallen race from sin and death and hell. The Son and God will to save are variously referred to in the second half of Hebrews 2. If you follow me with your eye upon the text, you'll see in verse 10 that Christ brings many sons unto glory, the sons of God. Verse 11 refers to us as they who are sanctified, consecrated to God. Christ is not ashamed, that verse goes on to say, to call us his brethren. And then comes a proof text, quoting from Psalm 22, Christ speaking, I will declare thy name, the name of God, unto my brethren. In the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. And Christ does that by his Spirit in the church as we sing his word. The next verse, 13, has Christ again calling us children. He says, behold, I and the children which God hath given me. Christ has given children, given them an election, and given them through the effectual law. Verse 17, we're called again Christ's brethren. And the last word in that verse, people, means that Jesus Christ reconciles us, propitiates our sins, and does that for the iniquities of the people of God. And every one of them and every one of us will be saved. And Hebrews 2, 14 and 15 is getting at this question. How is it that God can save man from sin and death and hell? The answer, in short, is that God must become a man. He must become a man in order to die as a man for us, because God is immortal. God cannot die. He must become a man to die for man's sins as a substitute. God, considered in himself, can't present himself as a substitute. He must become a man die in our place, and in so doing, to endure hell instead of us. And so our text begins, forasmuch then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same. That is, to identify with us, the children, Christ's own children. He knows who his children are and who his children are not. He becomes a man. The Creator becomes a creature. The one who is spirit becomes flesh. The infinite becomes circumscribed and limited, so that he is, let's say, 5'10" tall and about so broad. That's part of becoming a man, having a body, having a certain space. When we say that God became man, we don't mean that he was changed into man, so that though he once were God, he's no longer God, he's now completely man. We mean that the Son, in becoming man, did not cease to be God. He remained fully God, equal with the Father and the Spirit. The statement that the Son of God became man means, while remaining God, he took to himself, or assumed as his own, a human nature, which he united to himself, so that he, who was and is eternal God, also is temporal man. Now, in Hebrews 2, verse 14, says that since we are partakers of flesh and blood, he likewise took part of the same, that is, flesh and blood. Those two words, flesh and blood, are mentioned to emphasize the reality of his body, and also the weakness of his body. Flesh and blood. That gets tired, sore, that experiences pain. You'll note too the phrase flesh and blood, they're spoken of because it's going to deal with his death. And there is a certain sense in which at death you don't die as to your soul or spirit, you die as to your body. So though it doesn't mention here Christ's soul or spirit, it's not saying that he doesn't have a soul or spirit. We know from many other verses he does. Into thy hands I commend my spirit. My soul is exceeding sorrowful even unto death, he said. But here it talks of flesh and blood, speak of his real human nature in which he died and in which he was weak and suffered for us. The flesh was pierced and torn and the blood was shed. The symbolic actions, you will note, of the breaking of Christ's body and the pouring out of his blood in the sacrament. Now, when we say, too, that Christ had a human nature like us, there are at least a couple of main differences that need properly to be understood. Our human nature is single. But the Lord Jesus has two natures. He is God and man. We're simply human beings. He's both. But the human nature that he possessed is the same as ours, except for this one major difference, that his is perfectly sinless. He had physical flesh, but he had no spiritual flesh, in the sense of a sin principle inside him, unlike us. But essentially, his human nature and ours were the same, real, complete, weak, and mortal, that is capable of dying. So far then, we have been looking at the means of Christ's death, that he had to become a man, a physical man, flesh and blood, to die, because God is spirit and can't die. And that he has to become a mortal man to die, because God is immortal. The rest of the text consists of the two ends for which the Lord died. The first of which runs along these lines. Verse 14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that, this is the purpose, the goal, the first end of his death, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. The obvious question arising from this is, what does it mean that the devil has the power of death? Very good question, one which cropped up on Tuesday morning at our class on Revelation 20 in connection with the binding of Satan. How does the devil have the power of death? And we ought to say, first of all, what this most definitely does not mean. It does not mean that the devil determines or decrees the death of each individual human being. The devil does not determine how long you live, when you are going to die, in what place, the means of your death, or the circumstances surrounding it. God does that. He's infinite, eternal, and unchangeable. He is Lord, and he governs all things. And he's determined what will come to pass before he made the universe. And Satan, though a creature, a very powerful creature, much more powerful than us, he can no more decree what will come to pass than we can. You can't determine the events of this world, nor can he. Satan has the power of death, doesn't mean he decrees when people are going to die. It doesn't mean either that Satan governs history so that he infallibly brings to pass whatever he wants. Satan does not govern history. Satan directs and leads those who are in his kingdom to do various things, and he has some influence, sadly, with us yet, but he does not govern history. And this statement that the devil is or possesses the power of death doesn't mean either that when someone dies, Satan passes judgment upon them. God does that when someone dies, to make it even more clear. God does that with the ungodly. The holy and righteous God says at death to all of those outside of Christ whom he cuts off in their sins, you are wicked. I have given you time upon this earth. You have despised me, walked in wickedness, and now you must die. And you must die because I, Almighty God, am holy and just and true, and I am punishing you. There is wrath and curse in my act of taking from you the life I gave you, and which you wickedly abused from the day I gave it to you until the day I took away your breath. And now I am punishing you at death by ushering you into everlasting destruction. And now you see, just to step aside from our text one little second, the wretchedness of those false prophets and liars who preach at people's funerals that everybody's going to heaven, that dear so-and-so has departed and gone to be with the Lord, and all is well. Death is unnatural and divine judgment in the world. There ought not be death. There wouldn't be death but for sin. Which brings me to the key of understanding how the devil has the power of death, namely, the connection between sin and death. When you hear the word sin, you should almost always automatically think the word death. The two are joined. Ezekiel taught us that in chapter 18, verse 4. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The wages of sin is death, the only thing man ever earned or merited with God. Romans 6, verse 23. Sin, die. Sin, you get your wages. You die under God's wrath. Before sin entered the world, there was no death. Man dies because of sin. Sin and death, death and sin, go hand in hand. Now we're in a position to understand what it means when the text says Satan has the power of death. It means, first of all, that Satan introduced sin into the world and therefore death. He tempted Eve, who fell, and who then led Adam to his disobedience. And Adam's sin, we sin in Adam's death, we died. Satan has the power of death in that he introduced sin and therefore death into the good world that God had formed. Flowing from that, Satan is also the prince and god of this world. Two scriptural titles for him. The prince of this age, the god of this world. And as the prince and god of this world, that is, of the majority of human beings, the ones who govern, set the pace, lead the fashions and fads of this age, Satan deceives and tempts and beguiles man, so that man descends and sinks deeper and deeper into sin. He brought sin into the world, and then he keeps everyone walking in those evil paths. And having willfully chosen wickedness, man cannot but choose sin, because he is in bondage to Satan, and Satan will never let him go. Because legally, in God's just judgment, he belongs to the devil. That was your choice, God says to man, in the garden long ago, and you're bound to that choice. Satan makes it impossible, through the bondage of man's will, for that person to repent and turn to the Father. And then too, we must understand that death, spiritual death, is separation from God. Alienation from the one who is life. Enmity against Jehovah, which is death. So Satan then has the power of death in that he leads man into sin and death and enmity with God, and that he keeps him in sin and death and enmity with God. And also, Satan torments, just to show how vicious he is, he torments and vexes man with thoughts of death and destruction. Now here we need to distinguish carefully. God, through his word and man's conscience, convicts man of his sin, assures him of his impending destruction. God does that. But alongside that, and the two can often be very hard to distinguish, Satan does this too, for different ends, with a different purpose, to torment and annoy and mock him. He says to the sinner, I've got you in the way of sin and death, and you couldn't even leave my side if you wanted to, because you don't want to, and you're lost. You can't escape me. You will forever be mine and miserable. And that's why man doesn't like to think about death or the things that are most important in life. In 1 Timothy 1 verse 20, Paul speaks of the excommunication of Hymenaeus and Alexander, and he says, I have delivered them up to Satan. Because outside the kingdom of God, there only is the kingdom of Satan. He delivered them up to the kingdom of Satan to be tormented and vexed of the devil, with the hope that maybe they'll be brought to repentance. Now, having understood what it means that the devil possesses the power of death, you see how Christ destroys Satan by his death. The foundation and base of Satan's power and dominion lies wholly in sin. Now we work back the other way. When Jesus Christ willingly took our place, when all of our sins were imputed to him and reckoned to his account, when he bare the punishment due to us for them on the cross, that is, when he endured our hell, and he endured our death as a punishment on the cross, then he's destroying Satan. And the word destroyed is a strong one. The text says, through death Christ destroyed him that had the power of death. And here I need to add that destroyed here does not mean that Christ by the cross caused it so that Satan ceased to exist. In the same way that you could take a huge bomb and destroy a tree or a street so it was no longer there. That's not the idea. It doesn't mean either, this statement that Christ destroyed Satan, that at the cross Christ took Satan and hurled him into hell. Satan said he was about as a roaring lion. He wasn't cast into the lake of fire then, though he will be in the future. By his death, rather, Christ destroyed Satan in this sense. He died for the sins of his people. Because of this inseparable union between sin and death, our death is not and cannot be penal. Penal means a punishment. Our death is not a punishment from God. Those who die outside of Christ, their death is a punishment from God, but ours isn't. The punishment in death, which was due to us, Christ bore. And so though a Christian dies, and externally he dies just like the next man, his death is not God's cutting him off in wrath and anger and hatred. His death is a passageway into life. God says, in effect, I wish to take this person to be with me in heaven. I'm not going to rapture them all as I will do on the last day. I'm not going to take them up with a chariot as I did with Elijah. I'm not going to go on a walk with them as they did with Enoch when he was taken up into heaven. Most of them are just going to die, and that's the way I'm going to take them up. But their death, though outwardly, it may say cancer or heart attack, their death, spiritually and fundamentally, is different. One, it's grace, taking them through. The other one's wrath. One up, the other down, to put it in its most basic terminology. And that, of course, is the teaching Lord's Day 16 of our Heidelberg Catechism. So Satan's power over death, over us, is destroyed. Satan led us as part of the human race in Adam into sin and death, but Christ leads us out of it. We're no longer separated from and enemies of God, that is, dead spiritually, we're the friends and servants of Jesus Christ. Though we may not be very good friends at times, and we may not be very faithful servants, we're friends and servants for all that. To use the language of 1 Corinthians 15, death, which is the last enemy, death has lost its sting. And the sting of death is sin. The sting of sin is the law, which accuses and says, you must be punished. Christ took the sting out of death, so we don't go to the place of everlasting punishment. We go to be with the Father. This is a statement that Christ's death is the defeat of the devil that is often made in Scripture. Jesus Christ, according to Matthew 12, has bound the strong man, Satan, and is taking from him his goods, the elect, whom the devil formerly had power over. The devil has been judged and cast out of his dominion over those chosen in Christ. John 12, verse 31. Satan has been defeated, spoiled, and plundered, and Jesus Christ has triumphed over him. Colossians 2, 15. Which brings us now, more briefly, to the third point, which is the second end or purpose in our Savior's death. Before our conversion, verse 15 says, the child of God was subject to bondage. And bondage here means slavery. Child of God before union to Christ and conversion was a slave. The bondage spoken of here is the bondage to death. I reiterate, the bondage to death as penal, as a punishment from God. Death as curse, ushering us into hell before our conversion. And for all those outside of the Lord Jesus, they're under the bondage of death. The people, to various degrees and at certain times, feel and know this. To me, this was most graphic upon visiting a friend once in hospital. There was a woman in the adjoining bed. We spoke briefly with her, as you do when you come into hospital, you say hello and chat a wee while. And on leaving, and while we were talking with our friend, you could hear the odd word coming through the curtain, as one does, whether you like it or not. And what the woman said, and her whole behavior, was strange, bordering on bizarre. But I wasn't able to put my finger on it. I was thinking of what to say to the sick saint. My wife said to me afterwards, you know what the issue with that woman was? She's afraid of death. And it all made perfect sense. That's it. She was even physically trembling at times. She was afraid of death. That's an extreme case. But everyone who is outside of Jesus Christ is afraid of death. Everyone has a conscience, no matter how much it may be cauterized. And at various times, sometimes stronger than others, they know, if I die, I'm not going anywhere too pleasant. They're like Hamlet in Shakespeare's play. Death makes cowards of us all. This life is wretched, he says, but to go to another realm, who knows if it isn't really going to be a whole lot worse. So he didn't commit suicide then. Now I want to distinguish here too, because there is even a natural and not in itself sinful fear of death. That is, death involves the division of soul and body. You have no idea what it's like to be divided in soul and body, and nor do I. We're so united, we're so one, that we can conceive of it, but the idea of the two being ripped apart, of us being divided like that, it isn't natural. We shrink from that. Secondly, too, pain ordinarily accompanies death, and we shrink from pain. We sure do. So if someone thinks of death simply in terms of a departure from this world, a division from within, the pain, yeah, everybody shrinks from that. And in that sense, there's even a fear. That in itself is natural, healthy, and not sinful. But there is a fear of death, in that death is understood to be a punishment from God, being cut off from this world forever, in God's wrath, and being cast into hell in his fury. And that is in the heart and conscience of all outside of Jesus Christ. That's what Hebrews 10:27 calls a fearful expectation of judgment and fiery indignation. And the word fear, spoken of in our text and frequently through this sermon so far, we don't often analyze, but fear is the notion that something awful is going to befall me in the future. Here, that I'm going to die and go somewhere terrible. And then this fear is a perturbation of the mind, an anxiety and a dread, which according to the object feared, can be greater or lesser. But this anxiety, perturbation, vexation, strife, grief inside, that something awful is coming. And sometimes too, for the believer before his conversion, or for the unbeliever, this fear of death comes out of nowhere. Last thing he's expecting is to struggle. What if I were to die? where would I go? Sometimes it hits him when guilt strikes over some particularly awful sin, and the unbeliever is tormented with a sense of guilt too. Sometimes it's when they hear the word of God. At other times, it's when they're severely sick or in times of great danger. What will happen to me if I die? And our text calls this the bondage or slavery, this fear of death, which brings people into misery and wretchedness, and misery and wretchedness of slavery. A slave in which you're doing things which you don't want to do. You don't want to think about it. You don't want to experience it. You shrink from it. And it's totally involuntary, because a slave, if he's really a slave, doesn't want to be a slave. Doesn't want to do the things that he has to do. And this fear of death and punishment is involuntary. The sinner sins voluntarily. He does it because he wants to do it. But the consequences of his sin, the judgment, and the fear of it, that's involuntary. He doesn't want it, but God forces it upon him at certain times. And then the devil kicks him too, just to gloat over him and glee and see the misery of his dupes. Those in bondage, of course, want to escape. And the unconverted man wants to escape from the fear of death. He doesn't want to escape the only way that God says he can escape, through Jesus Christ, because he's in bondage to his sin. But he tries other ways out of the fear of death and punishment. Most people simply try to forget about it, dismiss it, change the subject in your head, put on another record, and let it go. Other people say evolutionism. Evolutionism. And out of the many things about evolutionism, we're especially interested in this point. Evolutionism says that death is wholly natural. There's no sting in death at all. Death's a good thing. And through dying, the whole race, hopefully, can become better and better. For others, whose conscience won't allow them away with that, they try salvation by their own good works. I can face death because I have some clothing. The Bible calls them filthy rags, in which I can, I hope, stand before God. Look at me in grace and pity. And our text says that in this state, the ungodly continue all their lives. And it's not saying that they're always perplexed and fearful of death, but it's saying that they can never be utterly free of it all their days. The text doesn't say they fear death all their lifetime, every second and every moment of the day. It says that they're subject to bondage all their life. They're held as slaves through this fear of death. And some of you here may remember this. You may remember what it was like before you were converted. You may remember there were times when you were terrified. Others amongst you cannot remember a time when you did not believe in Jesus Christ, so you wouldn't be able to remember it, but some can. And our text is saying that Jesus Christ delivered us from this because his death was penal. And with his death as penal, he destroyed him who had the power of death, who held us captive, bearing our judgment so that we are released. The purpose of this word of God is to assure and comfort the believer of this, both now, and then we fight it away whenever we're troubled, the devil tempts us, we're struggling with our own doubts, to comfort us that death is not wrath against us. And God gives us also, because of our weakness, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is about assurance. It's God saying to us in this visible, eatable, drinkable, pourable, breakable form, I bore the punishment due to you, so you will not be punished, and your death is not your destruction, but your death is a passage to a better world. And then you won't be crippled. And if I'm your minister and you're in a sick bed, you won't be troubled like that lady I mentioned earlier. Though we all struggle with these things to some degree, you'll be able to say, I believe in Jesus, he conquered death, he did it for me. And though it's a fearful thing to leave this body, I don't look at the notion of pain at all favorably. Christ is with me.